it's a real pleasure to welcome Dr. Abhi Preeti back. We were together a few weeks back. She was kind enough to host me at MIT for 3 years. There was a very pleasant trip, and she has been coming to us for a number of years. She has been a wonderful colleague at MIT. And we have a very strong collaboration going on at the moment, and from MIT has visited us and vice versa. Today I'm really looking forward to this talk. Last time that when we invited Abhi over, it was a smashing hit. The students really liked your presentation and examples that she touched upon. So we are very excited and looking forward to this module. So the module that, as you know, is systems analysis. But it will be touching on some complementary aspects of systems dynamics and how it connects to what we do.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Is this mic working okay? Can everybody hear me all right?
Okay.
All right. So, assalamu alaikum. It's always a great pleasure and privilege, I have to say, to come here, and thank you for inviting me, Abubakar. As you said, we certainly were discussing many of these things while we were visiting MIT a month ago, and it's great to be here. So, thank you all for coming. As Dr. Abubakar mentioned, I'll be talking about systems dynamics. I'll be touching upon this topic in 3 lectures. This is going to be the first one in which I'll introduce some concepts, ideas, definitions, notation. In the next one, I'll talk about some more details about modes of behavior and so forth. And the third one, we'll talk about stocks and poles and building some quantitative models. I'll get into the thick of things right away. When we talk about systems can mean very different things, right? It can be something perhaps complex or something simple, depending on who you talk to and what the element of analysis is. But when you saw Dr. Abubakar's presentation earlier on, he was showing you examples of systems of systems, right? Hydrological basins where people are living and technologies are being deployed and there's a natural system in play. Those are the sorts of systems I mean here, and I refer to here when I say the word system in this talk. And these systems are complex. So the first thing I want to sort of discuss is their complexity. We have to understand that these are not simple artifacts or simple mass damper or simple electrical circuits in which we can know and test and verify and experiment with and understand the behavior completely and holistically. The types of systems that we deal with where there are people involved, where there are technologies being used and they're operating in a natural environment, things get incredibly complex. Our world is complex, right? And it's interrelated. And because of this complexity and this interrelatedness, often the actions that we take or the interventions that we come in with to affect the system that we would might like to be in a certain way, they often backfire. So often our policies actually don't work the way we would like things, don't make things work the way we would like them to work, and so forth. In fact, sometimes instead of improving things, they make matters worse, right? So I'll give you some simple examples, they're very famous examples, antibiotic resistance. scientists for decades have done research and they came up with solutions to fight bacteria and infection and came up with antibiotics. But what has that led to? So as we use more and more antibiotics, the bacteria in turn have adapted and responded and then they mutated and now they're resistant to many of the common antibiotics that exist. And essentially a lot of people worry that we are heading towards a big pandemic or a big outbreak where some kind of mutation may arise where we won't have any antibiotics to kill the bacteria, right? Similarly for pesticides, the same thing. The pests have become resistant to the pesticides that are used, and now you need to either use more pesticides or need to come up with new ones, right? So the cycle continues. But even our effects our ability, actions to fight, or address the natural disasters such as fires and floods, what we will find is that the impacts of our actions have not necessarily led to the outcomes we think we would like to see, okay? So I'd like to use this code to, sort of elaborate on this idea. I really like this because it sets the tone for the rest of the lecture, and I'll read from this. This is from Thomas Lewis, who was a biologist. And he said that, when you're confronted by any complex social system with things about it that you're dissatisfied with and anxious to fix, you cannot just step in and set about fixing with much hope of helping. you cannot meddle with one part of a complex system from the outside without the almost certain risk of setting off disastrous events that we hadn't counted on in other remote parts. If you want to fix something, you're first obliged to understand the whole system. Intervening is a way of causing trouble. Okay, so this is a biologist thinking about the complexity of our natural world and understanding and appreciating how things are interconnected. And if we you know, meddle with just one element of the food chain or the food web or the, we are going to set off disastrous consequences and a cascading chain of impacts all through the system. So biologists actually understand this very well, but we as engineers sometimes forget these things. And we are taught to, you know, work with, I would say, simple systems, and are not fully appreciative of what our interventions can do in the complex world. So let me give you some additional examples before I go into the more specific ones. So here's an example of the policy resistance. What you see here is actual data of forest fires. Forest fires are a big issue in dry parts of the world where, you know, especially California. So this data actually comes from California. And what you see here on the blue line is the number of fires over a period of years. And what you can see is that the fires were growing in frequency over time, and there was a policy put in to reduce the number of fires that were happening, because every year the summertime would come in and the ground conditions would set off forest fires and release a lot of burning and damage and losses. So the government enacted a policy to reduce the frequency of fires. So that policy kicked in. And you can see that it certainly had an impact. You can see that the number of fires did go down. So in that respect, you know, the policy worked, but what happened in return? You can see the red line, which is actually showing you the damage from fires. So what started to happen was that although the number of fires went down, the damage caused by the smaller number of fires was actually much larger than what the many fires together was contributing. So on one hand, our narrow focus on reducing the number of fires did just that, but it actually backfired. And the actual thing that we really didn't care about was the damage. So what was going on? Well, what happened was, which people hadn't thought of before, was that as the firefighting policy was enacted to reduce fires, it led to fewer fires, and because of that, there was accumulation of dry matter. So dry grass, you know, dead trees or wood matter and so forth, just dry matter accumulating because now there are less fires to consume them. And they would accumulate and pile up. And then when occasionally a fire would happen, now there's a lot of material in the burn, a lot of material the fire to consume, and it would just become a big conflagration and cause massive, much more damage than what the smaller fires were causing. Similarly, let me give you another example. When we try to fight floods, I found this picture. I wish I had something analogous for the Indus, but we'll use this. This is actually the river in Italy, and this is from a paper published recently, showing in a very nice way the feedbacks that we find when we try to fight or protect ourselves from floods and what that does to flood damage. So what you see here essentially is a schematic representation of the construction of levees on the right-hand side. And on the left-hand side, you see the level of floods that came into the river over a course of basically 3 centuries, okay? So starting off in the 1600s, you can see this was the level of flood, and then a higher levee was built. Then in 1799, the flood level got higher, and 1821, they built higher levees. So the floods keep getting high, and you know, they build higher and higher levees. So what's going on here, and for how long can we continue to do this? Well, what's going on here is basically, essentially, by building levees to control flood, we have certainly decreased the frequency of floods, for sure. But often, sometimes, when there is a massive flood that does come in, it creates actually a lot more damage. So the intensity has increased, as you can see, right? The flood level is getting higher and higher as, well, you know, as we go over these 3 centuries. And the reason is that some hydrologists essentially observe is that by building levees, you are reducing the attenuation power, right? Because now all the water is constrained. Previously, it can dissipate and so forth, but now you're constraining the water more and more, and you're decreasing the conveyance of the cross section, which is now channeling all the water into this stream. And sometimes, occasionally, when you get very large precipitation event, much more devastation, and there are other more dynamics setting in. One key dynamic that leads to the increased devastation is that the levees give you a sense of protection, thinking that now we build these protective measures, so people start moving into the floodplains. And they build buildings and they make settlements, and when the big flood does come, now there's much more damage to be done. Similarly, like the wildfire example, where there's dry matter accumulating, here, populations start settling in the floodplains. And when a flood does come, where the levee is unable to control, now you're talking about that. So, you know, there are these a lot of things that are happening, and you'll find similarities in many, many other cases. I've just touched upon these two, but I want to show that, you know, they represent this so-called law of unintended consequences, right? So you all know Newton's law, right? Newton's third law: for every action, there's a an opposite reaction. So geotechnical systems, as you know, Dave Forrester says, there's a law of unintended consequences. So for every action, there's going to be some unintended consequence. Okay. So our actions basically, you know, tend to make either problems worse. The social systems often have counterintuitive behavior, right? Behavior that we haven't anticipated. Who knows Murphy's Law? Yes. That's right. If anything can go wrong, it will go wrong, right? So these are things that are absolutely applicable to complex systems that we're talking about, right? And these unexpected dynamics are the cause that often lead to the policy that we're talking about, right? The tendency for interventions to be delayed or that are needed or defeated by the response of the system to the intervention itself. And why does that happen? Because we often have a serial world of cause and effect. That is how we've been trained to think, and that is how most of us humans think, right? We typically tend to think of things as chains of cause and effect, right? And we often ignore the time delays between them. So oftentimes we have some kind of situation, and there is a desired state where we would rather be, that's our goal. Collectively, these two things define the problem we want to address. Based on this problem, we take some decision, and we expect some results out of those decisions. In narrow, finite cases, it often works, but over the long term, it typically backfires. So let me show you, for example, the flood example that I showed you just recently. This is sort of the chain of thinking that has typically played out, right? So society wants safety from floods, and they need that the protection is inadequate, so which is leading to flooding in the plains. So they construct levees, right? And then once the levees are constructed, I'll let you decide, you know, what the results have been. Okay, so in the short term, you may see some protection, but over the long term, you don't know, right? Okay, so the feedback view is this, that in reality, things are not just chains of cause and effect. In reality, there is actually feedback going on in the natural world, in the complex world that you live in, okay? So the results of present actions define our future situation. They define our future system that we're dealing with. And policy resistance is often due to the incomplete understanding and accounting of full range of feedbacks. Okay, so when our policy backfires, because we haven't fully accounted for all the side effects and for all the feedbacks that might be going on. So in reality, we don't have chains. We can think of situations more like this, where we have some goals that we want to meet. We make decisions, but our decisions have side effects. Okay, those decisions impact the environment, but those side effects are also impacting the environment. Excuse me. And then in turn, you can see that the environment changes, which actually affects our goals, right? So we were building higher and higher levees, right? So our goal keeps getting changed as a result of the changing environment. And when the environment changes, there are goals of other agents that also come in, right? So other stakeholders, other organizations, or other, you know, entities may come in. They will act on their own accord based on their goals, and based on their actions, again, the environment or system that we're dealing with will get affected. So there are all these feedbacks and loops in play that we often don't account for and actually completely disregard when we are deciding about our own course of action, or when we are trying to think of things, or when we are trying to analyze the situation. So essentially, this feedback view is often limiting, but often very, but also extremely important to consider. So let me give you a simple, a very famous example, one that I actually find very interesting and fascinating. The one of the eradication of mosquitoes, right? So mosquitoes are connected with stagnant water. They also have a deep connection with, waterborne diseases and so forth. But I will specifically talk about mosquito eradication here. So how many of you have heard the name DDT? Almost all of us, right? Living in Park Slab, right? We grow hearing this term. So DDT is a chemical compound, right? It's dichlorodichnyltrichloroethane. So got that right. All right, so DDT was developed in the 1930s and was actually used in the Second World War to protect troops fighting in various, mosquito infested regions and so forth by the U.S. and other countries. For civilian use, it became available in 1945 and it was considered, quote-unquote, a miracle compound because it would essentially eradicate the mosquitoes and all the attendant problems that they brought with them and all the diseases. So it was considered a huge success, as I said, a miracle compound, right? But some people were a little concerned. They were expressing second thoughts on how good DDT actually is. One of them was Edwin Tew, who was a biologist, and he warned, I'm quoting actually from a very nice article, in which he said that a spray as indiscriminate as DDT can upset the economy of nature, as much as a revolution upsets social economy. Okay? 90% of all insects are good. And if they are all killed, things go out of control right away. So DDT is essentially destroying the insects, all the, it's not just the mosquitoes, but many, many other beneficial insects that are part of the ecosystem, that are part of the natural fabric of any ecosystem that thrives, okay? And there were many others. The most famous one was Rachel Carson. Who has heard the name Rachel Carson before? One hand. So she wrote a very famous and seminal book called Silent Spring. She was an environmentalist, actually, and she was trained as an environmental engineer. And she basically noticed, was very concerned about the impact of DDT and many other chemicals that were being used for, increasing crop yields and pesticides and so forth, specifically DDT. And she started doing some research. And she essentially found that DDT was making its way into the food web and all the way up to even humans, right? She essentially found that DDT was the insects that were being killed off with this chemical were actually eaten by birds, right, by fish, and ultimately it was making the chemical was all the way up to the humans. The book, her famous book is named Silent Spring, and she named it because what she found was that one of the impacts of DDT was that the eggshells were becoming very thin, and they were not viable to lead on to chicks. So these birds in the spring were disappearing, and hence the name of her book, Silent Spring. And she essentially, traced the impact of this chemical in the natural ecosystem, and her efforts basically led to the establishment of the first environmental movement in the U.S. in the 1970s. The Environmental Protection Agency finally took notice, and DDT was banned.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Because of the severe harmful impact of the chemical problems. Okay? It has been found to cause cancer and genetic mutations in humans. So it is a carcinogen, it has a severe side effect. Okay? So the reason I'm telling you the story is that although on one case we solve one problem, killing the mosquitoes, we have created other very serious problems with side effects that actually impact directly us and many other parts of our natural world. So what I'm trying to advocate for and trying to illustrate in these stories, if you will, is that there's a critical need for systems thinking, right? To move away from the serial worldview and to think about the fact that you can't just do one thing. Things that are interconnected in our complex world and actually have numerous effects, some that we may not be able to anticipate or even know upfront at all. So what system thinking is all about is essentially taking these three aspects in view. Take a long-term view of your actions. Okay? Don't focus on the short term. Take a long-term view of what our actions might do to the system. Think about change in systems. So the actions that we are taking to affect any change on a system, that system in turn will change in the future. And how will that play out? Also considering the direct as well as indirect impacts of our actions and their side effects, okay? And then once we do all of that, we might be better positioned to identify high leverage points so that we can avoid policy resistance. We can avoid, you know, backfire from the system on which you're trying to intervene. Okay? And the reason we want to think about all of these issues is because of these special characteristics of complex systems, right? So how many of you are engineers here in the audience? Okay? So I see some hands, all right? So, you know, so students of engineering and perhaps even mathematics and sciences and many others, many disciplines, you're often taught and are steeped in linear systems too, okay? We are trained to think about and work with linear systems because the math works out very nicely, and there's a lot of theory and nice methods that are out there. And they're certainly incredibly useful. They're absolutely very powerful, for sure. But when we start intervening with policies and actions in the real world is not linear. In fact, it is highly nonlinear. And understanding that nonlinearity is absolutely essential. So in these complex systems, there are these specific properties that we may not find in normal linear systems that we may have been taught to work with. So the first one is of adaptation, right? The complex systems are adaptive. The capabilities and decision rules of agents in complex systems change over time, right? So we are talking about human agents, we are talking about the natural system. These are adaptive systems, right, that are changing and responding. Counterintuitive, right? So cause and effect might be distant in time and space. Complex systems are characterized by trade-offs, right? So often the short-term and the long-term is very different. So the action that you may take in the short-term, they actually may make things worse in the short-term, but in the long-term, it actually might be beneficial. And closer, okay? Governed by feedback. This is what I just sort of emphasized just now. Non-linear, right? History-dependent. Again, this is something important, that the system that we're dealing with in the type of system that we're dealing in complex systems is that they're history-dependent. You can't go back and reverse things, right? So their initial conditions matter, and everything that you have done to them accumulates in those systems. But we can't just go back and reverse them and bring them back to the original state always. So the example being that you can't unscramble an egg, right? This is a non-linear system. Dynamic. Right, so dynamic complexity arises when you have interactions among different agents over time. Okay, and systems even the few elements actually can exhibit dynamic complexity. And this is the aspect that I'm going to focus mostly on in this module, thinking about the dynamics of the different that complex systems undergo and how to think about them more holistically. So I hope I've conveyed to you the you know, through these examples and these concepts, the need, I guess, for system thinking. And as you know, the epoch or the geological age that we now live in, I think there's still voting going on. I don't know if it's been officially decided, but unofficially it is called the Anthropocene, right? The age of the humans, right? So we've moved on to a new era in which the human actions are so large and so intense that they are changing the processes of our planet in significant ways, that now geologists essentially are calling for this current age, starting from, I believe, the 1950s, to be the Anthropocene, right? So in this Anthropocene, where we are, our actions are impacting our entire planet, I and many others argue that actually systems thinking is actually critical for our very survival, okay? It's actually critical for the sustainability of our planet and for the sustainability and survival of the human species. Why? Well, I just gave you some examples of floods and droughts and pandemics. These are events and these are things that can actually impact our society in very intense and significant ways, many others. So if you recognize that we need system thinking, the first thing we need to recognize is the limitations of our own mind. So on one way, on one dimension, I'm asking you to think differently, and I'm also asking you to recognize that you cannot think enough, okay? We actually have significant limitations on our own cognitive abilities, right? And so Herbert Simon, who wrote a very famous book, Sciences of the Artificial, right? He wrote very, very eloquently about the capacity of the human mind not being sufficient to formulate and solve complex problems, right? We just don't have the ability to do that, and essentially need the help of computers and machines to help us think through these nonlinear, or at least analyze these nonlinear complex systems. So let me just give you one example. Let's do this puzzle together. Now that the room is full, we might get some more participation. So here's a little question. So we have these four cards, okay? Question is that the statement is that each card has a letter on one side and a number on the other. Okay, so I've put these four cards in front of you, and behind each of these cards is either a letter or a number. That's how the cards are, okay? So if that's true, then what is the smallest number of cards that need to be turned over to test the rule that vowels have even numbers on the reverse? Who wants to solve this puzzle? So what are the cards that should be turned over out of these four that I'm showing you to test the rule that vowels have even numbers on the reverse? So let's play this. Who wants to volunteer an answer?
I'll
take hands. Okay, perfect. So you're saying four, okay. So if I flip four, and I find what? I find some kind of letter. Sorry? So if I flip four, what am I looking for? Okay, so how many people think, so let me make this simple, how many people think we need to flip one card? Okay. How many people think we need to flip two cards? How many people are playing the game? Because I need to normalize. Okay. These are the four cards. These are the four cards. These are the four cards. E, K, 4, and so, okay, so there are five vowels. There are five vowels, right? A, E, I, O, U. Yeah. But you know, which cards should be... So out of just these four cards, we don't have a deck. So there are just these four cards. And as I said, behind each, you know, each card has a letter and a number on one side. So to test this rule, how many cards do we need to flip? Okay, we have a steady hand there.
We have to flip two cards.
Okay, two cards. Which one?
E and four.
E and four. Okay. All right. So anybody else? Any other answers?
E and four.
E and four.
E and four. That's an unanimous vote.
Yes.
Seven and
eight. Only one card? Okay. So the correct answer is indeed two, but the cards are not E and four. The cards are E and seven. You know why? Because if we flip four and it gave us a consonant, so what? The rule doesn't say anything about consonants. So we actually have to flip seven for falsification. Because E would confirm, because we flip E and if we do find it, then yes, it will confirm. And then to falsify, to prove that, you know, seven doesn't have it, we have to look actually at seven for falsification. So this is actually a consistent feature of the human mind. This is actually a very famous puzzle. It's called the Watson card puzzle. He was a psychologist, and he used this in his experiments, and he finds that actually the finding that we just had in this audience to be robust. Even people with technical and logical and quantitative training, it is robust in the finding that we do not seek falsification. Just as humans. This is a very common feature for us in the way we think. So we seek affirmation, but we do not seek falsification. Okay. So the correct answer is E and 7 to make sure that rule holds. Okay. So I was just trying to demonstrate the limits of the human mind, and that's why I put this up. So what I'm trying to sort of make the point here is that Our cognitive limits we have cognitive limitations and cognitive biases. And to overcome all of these, we take the help of simulation, and we take the help of model, and we take the help of group thinking and collaboration to perhaps overcome some of these limitations, okay? So I'm going to make a case for simulation in which we essentially create models that allow us to make our mental models explicit because we formalize what we are thinking in our mind through equations and through representation, which then helps us see how our defined system structure will behave in time, and it also helps us discuss what we think to be the case with others and perhaps come to a resolution. And by formalizing qualitative models and testing their simulations, we often can understand reality in radically different ways, okay? And discrepancies between formal and mental models stimulate improvements both in our own basic assumptions as well as other hypotheses of the model, okay? So what do I mean by mental models? Mental models are essentially our conceptualizing of how things are working, okay? So it's a specific term which we call mental models and system dynamics, and essentially conceptualization of how we think things are working. Okay? So Forrester, who is the founder of system dynamics, essentially said that most of the decisions that we make are based on our own mental models. We have mental models of how the world works, how things are working, and based on our mental conceptualization and understanding, we take our actions. Okay? So mental model essentially is a belief of networks of causes and effects that describe how a system operates. All right? So what is system dynamics now, more formally, now that I've set the stage for all of this? So essentially it's a method that helps us learn and understand complex systems, okay? So we're not talking about system dynamics of, let's say, a spacecraft or a car in motion or a ship on the ocean. What we are talking about when I mention system dynamics in this class is a specific type of method that has been developed in a formal way that allows us to understand model complex systems, okay? It's fundamentally a disciplinary, okay? And there's a wide number of disciplines. Sorry about that. It's extremely interdisciplinary, right? It touches upon a number of different fields. But at its core, it essentially derives from control theory. In fact, the founder of system dynamics is a controls engineer, Forrester. I'll talk about it. It uses a lot of nonlinear dynamics, but as well as social psychology, economics, and so forth. Okay, and we use system dynamics to construct models of socio-technical systems. All right, to describe the systems in the real world. Here's a picture of Jay Forrester. He's a professor at MIT. He's also famously known to be the inventor of RAM. Random access memory in computers. So actually, he had a very stellar career. He was an engineer by training and essentially worked in the 1940s, 1940s and so forth, on early computers. And in fact, it's considered to be the father of random access memory. So he moved on to start looking at more complex problems. In the 1950s, he actually started looking at and applying concepts from control theory to social systems. So urban dynamics, essentially the dynamics that play out in cities, how cities basically renew and grow and change over time, and dynamics of organizations. In fact, one of the first things that he did, which led to the most formal theory of system dynamics, was his work with General Electric, GE, the company, who basically had asked him a question about issues they were having about certain employee hiring and turnover and many other rates. And he basically applied his control systems principles to study that problem and realized that actually it is very broadly applicable and went on to found the field of system dynamics. He passed away last year, actually, I had the good pleasure of attending some of his lectures and so forth. System dynamics has its, people, some people love it. Some people find its limitations to be too big to be useful. But nonetheless, it is actually a very useful tool for education and learning, and it's a very useful tool for enhancing our understanding. So it has its own place, its own strengths and limitations, which we will go over in this lecture and the next two ones that I will go through. So, what systems dynamics is about, essentially it consists of qualitative conceptual and quantitative numerical modeling methods, okay? So it combines qualitative aspects in which we formalize our mental models and describe how we think things are working in a qualitative sense, as well as it allows us to do quantitative modeling and so forth. Okay. The modeling process, typically, a good modeling process, typically will work something like this. That we first identify what is the problem. So whenever we start off in creating a model, we first have to ask that question. We don't create a model just because we like to create them. We create a model for a very specific purpose. There is a specific problem that we want to address, or a specific case, or an issue, or a thing that we want to understand, and we want to look into. So we first have to know what is the problem, identify what are the key variables, and what is the time horizon. Okay, so over what period of time are we looking at this issue? And what period of time are we going to be analyzing the behavior of the system and so forth? These are not trivial questions. These are not trivial questions. Actually, these questions, getting them right, will set the tone of your analysis and perhaps success and the validity and the credibility of your analysis. Okay, so once, second step, what are the current theories of problematic behavior, right? So you have to understand, you know, what are the current hypotheses that are out there that essentially describe the problem and represent what is going on. You then create simulations, okay? You then check if your model reproduces the problematic behavior, right? So you try to do some kind of validation and benchmarking of your model. And then once you at least have some faith that your model can faithfully produce behavior that you've seen in the past, because you do have data of the past. We don't have data of the future, but certainly have data of the past. So once we have established some kind of credibility that our model is reproducing behavior that you've seen in the past, only then, dare I say, can you make projections for the future. But again, recognizing that models will have limitations and the unintended consequences and the side effects that I just mentioned, you may not be able to fully capture them, but nonetheless. All right, and but with system dynamics, you are better prepared than many other modeling approaches to look at those feedbacks and unintended consequences, okay? And then number six is that once you have a working system, then you can play with it to see what the effects of a policy strategy might be on your system. So let me step back and give you details about some of these steps that I just highlighted. So I mentioned the horizon time, right? To select the right horizon time. So if you're trying to understand the trend or the trajectory or the behavior of a system, selecting the horizon time is very crucial. So here what you see is is a chart of the world population, okay, over a long period of time, actually, almost 50 years here. And what is the trend that I see for world population? 1960 to 2017. Sorry? It doubles, but what's sort of the shape of the line here? We're seeing a linear trend, right? So it has just slow. It has a high slope, but it's linear, right? It's increasing rapidly, but in a linear sense, right? Over the last 50 years. So we may choose to model the population linearly. If we are going to project it into the future, is that a good choice to make a linear projection? So in the last 40 years, this is what the population has looked like. So if you want to project it for the next X years, what's a good representation of the form of the function? Okay, now let me give you a different perspective. Lower population since 200 AD. What does this shape look like? Exponential, right? So just by shifting essentially the time horizon, suddenly the shape of the curve is dramatically different. Right, and this is a very common feature. Right? This is a very common feature when we work with time series, or when we work over long time periods. That over long time periods, our assumptions of linearity do not hold. In fact, the system is radically different. And this is important to understand because oftentimes we are making models and trying to project into decades into the future. And when we are trying to make such types of projections or trying to understand what would happen decades into the future, need to be very cautious. Okay, so next, formulating a hypothesis, right? As I mentioned earlier, right, moving away from the serial view, we're trying to understand what are all the feedbacks and side effects and many other things that may be going on when we intervene with the system, all right? So that's what we call formulating a hypothesis, and we formalize it using specific types of representation, which we call causal loop diagrams, okay? So causal loop diagrams, or CLDs for short, are essentially maps. They are maps of a mental model. They are maps that show how a particular issue or a problem is working. And they're very specific notation that is used to create CLDs. And I'm going to walk through that notation because I think it's important to do that. You know, a lot of people attempt to create CLDs, but I've seen, you know, all kinds of things happen. So I think it's very important to spend time and make sure that they're all on the same page. There are different types of notations that are used, but we need to be consistent. So the type of notations and the definitions that we will use are as follows. So one is that a causal loop diagram essentially shows cause and effect relationships between variables, hence the name causal loop, all right? So the relationship will be shown with an arrow, and if you see this type of diagram, it essentially means that A causes B, all right? So there's a causal relationship between A and B, each link, which these blue arrows we call causal links, will be labeled with a plus or a minus sign. We call this link polarity, okay? So this plus or minus sign is called the link polarity. And this link polarity has a very specific meaning. It is not trivial. It has a very specific and definite meaning. It essentially means that if you have a positive sign, if you have a positive polarity, it essentially means that A and B move in the same direction, okay? What does that mean? Basically it means that if all else equal, right? So think of a big complex map, right? I showed you the feedback and all that happening. It typically, right, that's the type of diagram you'll be dealing with. But when you take, when you focus on one causal link, you put everything at a constant. You put everything, you fix everything, and then you say that if all else equal, if A increases, then B will also increase. That's what a positive polarity means. It also means that if A decreases, B will also decrease. Okay? So please don't confuse that plus means always increasing and a minus polarity means decreasing. No, that's not what it means. So a positive polarity means that A and B move in the same direction. They're positively correlated. Okay? So essentially, the mathematical definition is this. Okay? To give you one example, very simple example, right? So as birds go up, the population goes up, okay? If birds go down, the population will not go up, right? It will either stabilize or will go down, okay? So maybe I should have used another example, but you get the idea, right? So it basically means if A decreases, then B will also decrease below what it would have been, by the way. So let me emphasize that this also, okay? Below what it would have been. So we're keeping everything else fixed, and then you say that if A goes up, then B also goes up above what it would have been, and similarly, if A decreases, then B decreases. So maybe I should have added another variable over there. But in any case, in the case of accumulation, A adds to B, okay? And we'll get to that in the next lecture. Negative link polarity, this is the opposite, right? So if all else equal, if A increases, B decreases. So this is the negative correlation, okay? So they move in opposite directions, all right? And this is the specific meaning of the negative polarity, all right? So here again, I use the, so deaths and population, right? So what happens? When deaths increase, the population decreases. So that's why I have the negative sign, okay? Now, assign and polarities, okay? So the causal links show what would happen if there were a change of any kind in the system, okay? That's what the causal links are showing. It's not showing this is exactly what would happen. This is what will always happen. No, please keep that in mind. So a causal link just shows what would happen if a change happened to A, right? It does not represent what will exactly occur, all right? We don't know that. For that, we simulate the whole system to find out what actually happens, right? And also remember that what actually happens is due to a confluence of multiple variables, right? So a single effect may be, B may be getting affected by a number of inputs, not just A, but there might be a C and a D also feeding into B, right? So essentially, an increase in cause may not necessarily increase the effect because it's the confluence of many other things that is going to affect what actually takes place, okay? So a causal loop diagram describes the hypothesis about the causal loop dynamics. They show the system structure, but not behavior, okay? They're not showing how the system is behaving. They're showing the underlying structure, right? The feedbacks and the effects and so forth that are leading to some kind of emergent behavior that defines the simulation, okay? And when determining polarity, assume that all other variables are constant and then determine the relationship between cause and effect, okay? So these are just some rules that I've listed out as a summary for keeping in mind when we're assigning polarities to the links. Now the links themselves, don't take the links lightly in the causal loop diagram. When we put a link between two variables, we are stating that there is a causal relationship. And we have to be careful between causation and correlation, right? So the causal diagrams must include only genuine causal relationships, okay? And you can actually end up with serious policy judgments if you erroneously confuse causation and correlation. So for example, let's say we are looking at two data sets, number of Wall's ice cream sales, let's say in Lahore, okay, over the year, January to December, and we're looking at number of patients admitted in Gangaram, let's say, okay, over the year. And when we look at the data trends, we say that, every time the ice cream sales go up, there are more patients in the hospitals. There must be something wrong with the ice cream, right? So as the district commissioner, do we ban the ice cream? Or do we say that, no, wait a second. Actually, there's no causation. There is some underlying issue that is leading to the correlation that we're seeing. And the underlying issue is temperature. So perhaps in the summer months, you have more mosquitoes and more food poisoning and all other types of things setting in the summer where people are likely to fall sick as compared to the winter, and you see the number of hospitalizations go up. So there's some underlying cause that leads to the increase in the number of patients that show up in the hospitals and the ice cream sales, which is basically the temperature, right? So the kids want to eat their ice cream, but the temperature is also. So this is a simple example, but to just sort of relate the pitfalls that often are very common and people, sometimes stumble on, that we have to be very careful between causation and correlation, okay? All right, so a note about loops, all right? So in most causal loop diagrams, the links are organized in a way that they form a loop, all right? So this is one example, and these loops result because of feedback in the system. And there are two kinds of feedbacks. So self-reinforcing, which we call positive feedback loops, and self-correcting, or negative or balancing loops that we call it, okay? So for example, what you see here is that effort leads to results, okay? And this is positive polarity. So the more the effort, the more the results you get. And then results, in turn, propel you to make more effort. So this is a sort of a representation when you're studying for your degree program, right? So you put in some effort in your studies and you get good grades. The good grades propel you to do the harder work and to move on, okay? It's a very common dynamic that you find. Okay, so this type of loop is called a reinforcing loop. We represent it with this type of notation, with the R in the center. And it has the same orientation as the direction of the loop, okay? So it's going clockwise, so we put a clockwise R in there. All right. This is called a reinforcing loop. We can also have balancing or negative loops. Okay. So, for example, here's a simple example again. Right. So you have your coffee temperature or the temperature of your chai, right? Your teacup, and there's room temperature in which your chai is, right? So the difference between the temperature of your chai and the temperature of the room determines how fast your chai will cool down, right? So if you're in an air-conditioned room, it'll cool much faster, right, than if we're outside. The loop will work until the coffee temperature and the room temperature are the same, right? This type of dynamic is called a balancing loop, all right? And you represent it with the B, and you can again see that the directionality of the loop matches the direction in which the loop is moving. So a note about loop polarity. How do we define or really know which one is a reinforcing or which one is a balancing loop if we have many, many variables? What's the way of determining that, okay? So here's the right property. So the polarity essentially is determined by following the effect of a change in a variable through the loop, all right? So if the change is amplified, then it's a reinforcing loop. And if the change is opposed, then it becomes a balancing loop, all right? So to give you an example, let's say we have three variables here. So we have this type of a loop, and you can see that if A1 goes up, then A2 will increase, in turn A3 will increase, and when A3 increases, A1 also increases. So the effect is amplified. All right, so let me draw it out for you, sort of show you good practice of building causal loop diagrams on how we show the effect as we trace out a loop. So these are just good practices to follow, okay? So can everybody see this on the screen? All right, so we have A1, A2, and by definition, we said this is positive polarity, right? That's just the nature of our causal loop diagram. Everything is positive here, right? So we say that A1 goes up, right? We're going to trace the effect. So when A1 goes up, what happens to A2? It's positive polarity. So A2 also goes up above what it would have been, right? When A2 goes up, A3 will go up because, again, positive polarity. When A3 goes up, what happens to A1? Again, we have positive polarity, so this also goes up. So these two arrows match. This is called a positive reinforcing loop. This I've used a very simple example, and you can see it right away. But for more complex loops, it's not very obvious. So following it through becomes very important, okay? So I'm just demonstrating it with a simple example here first. And now similarly, let's say we have some other cases, okay? So we have a case of a balancing loop, right, over here. So now let me show you how this would work for B1, B2, and B3, right? So we have B1. Actually, I'll just erase this. All right, so we have B1, B2, and B3. And we have one difference, that we have a negative polarity for B3, right? Between B2 and B3. So now what happens? So when B1 goes up, right? B2 goes up, right? When B2 goes up, what happens to B3? It goes down, right? It goes down, okay? And when B3 goes down, what happens to B1? It goes down, because it's positive polarity, so they move in the same direction, right? Did everybody get that? Right? So B1 goes up, B2 goes up, because of positive polarity. Now, with an increase in B2, what will happen to B3? Well, we see that the causal link has negative polarity. It means that they move in opposite directions. So when B2 is increasing, B3 is going to decrease. So this is what happens to B2. It decreases. Now, B3 has decreased. And what happens to now B1? They move in the same direction. This is positive polarity. So when B3 goes down, B1 also goes down. Okay? So this is a balancing loop. So the effect of the change is reversed. Because that's what the starting point, okay? Now, you can see a quick and dirty way, right, of identifying loop polarity, which is to count the signs on the loop, right? So this is what we call the fast way, right? So you can count the positive polarities on the link. So this is all, you know, positive, so we don't just reinforce it. Here, you have one negative sign. So you can immediately know this is going to be a balancing loop, all right, without having to go through all of that. What happens here? Is this, well, I've already given you the answer, but can somebody tell me why this is reinforcing? Mm-hmm. Exactly, right? So we have even number of reversals going on, so it ends up being reinforcing. I don't want to be boring, but do people want me to go through this to make sure?
Yes.
No? Okay. So this is the fast way of counting the signs, okay? But the right way is what I showed you over there. And why did I call that the right way? Because many times when you draw the causal loop diagram, you put the polarities thinking about, you know, how they're linked. And sometimes you make a mistake. So when you follow that route, you are more likely to catch your mistake. essentially. So that's why it's called, one is the fast way and one is the right way. And the right way is what I showed you on the board, okay? But the fast way is to count the signs. All right. So one other feature that we can put and is important in causal diagrams is time delays, okay? So for time delays that are often give rise to complex dynamics, okay, we use essentially representation of these boxes. And the effect of a cause may be distant in time, right, rather than immediate. And we represent a delay along any causal link using this type of equation. So what this essentially is showing you is that, you know, when rainfall comes in, the reservoir level in the dam goes up. When the reservoir level in the dam goes up, that leads to, after some delay, leads to, you know, increased city water use. So this is, you know, thinking about a city where, let's say, all the water is supplied by a dam. When the dam is full, you know, people are watering their lawns and they're using water as they like to. But because of the extensive city water use, after some delay and if the rains will come in, the reservoir level may go down. And that may enact the city to perhaps, you know, conduct some, to, you know, enforce some policies and so forth, but that takes a little bit of time. And we represent that as delay. So there's a lot packed into this diagram, much more. I mean, I explained a lot more than what you see here, but you can sort of understand the reason why you may choose to put a delay in there. It all depends on the types of dynamics that you want to capture. Okay, so now moving on to single loop diagrams, I'm just going to show you a very simple two loop diagram here, and then real complex cross loop diagrams are much more complex. So here's a simple diagram that shows us the population level, births, and deaths in a region. In a country or in a city, whatever your area of analysis. So you can see that there's a reinforcing loop between population level and births, and there's a balancing loop between population level and deaths. Okay? Births are affected by these exogenous variables, which we call the birth rate and average lifespan and so forth. And the population level, you can see, actually functions as a result of these two loops operating, right? So what happens is that, in real cases, what happens is that if your births are a lot more than deaths, this reinforcing loop is actually dominant. And that leads to sort of the rising or exponential behavior from the data that you just saw. In some cases, there may be more deaths than births, right? You know, there are cases, right, where the birth rate is not as high as needed for staying the population level and the deaths are more, then the balancing loop becomes dominant. And essentially that leads to a stabilization of the population or in some cases, even decay. Okay, even decline. All right, so we'll go into that in a lot more detail in the next lecture, but I just wanted to show you how this works out. So just some you know, good rules to draw CLDs by. So one is that, you know, you must make your polarities very clear, right? So the links must have unambiguous polarity, right? And sometimes it may be unclear. When you choose two variables and you can't really decide, do I put a plus or a minus, then that's an indication that you need another variable, okay? So that means basically you need to add another variable until things become absolutely clear and you've elaborated all the pathways, okay? Similarly, you know, you want the logic to be completely specified and represented. So for example, you'll find a lot of paper and a lot of discussion that, you know, global warming is leading to social unrest. So you could put, you know, this type of a diagram, right? And there's actually a lot of, you know, research and people are, you know, writing about this, that global warming is leading to social unrest. So, but what they're really seeing are a lot of different things. And there are a lot of different pathways that are connecting those two variables. So one such pathway or one hypothesis that people have put out is that global warming is leading to droughts and floods, which in turn is leading to crop failures, which in turn is affecting food supply, which is then leading to social unrest. Okay? So this type of practice is not good. A is not good practice. B is much better way of representing the system. Okay? Because then that allows you to clarify the pathways that you are applying, and then also then identify the interventions, right? And also affect and also determine clearly what the polarities might be. Okay, now goals of negative loops. Negative loops will always have a goal, right? The balancing loop will always have some kind of desired state. Sometimes it's explicit, sometimes it's implicit. And good practice in good CLTs is to make the goals explicit, okay? And what does that do? When you make the goals explicit, so here, for example, the goal is, you know, the desired state that you represented here. It helps you think through how the goals are actually formed and how they may change over time. Because that can lead to the nonlinear or the changing or the unexpected behavior of the system. So actually making the goals of the system explicit is very good practice, all right? So let's work through a simple example. So I put down these variables listening to Dr. Abubakar's talk in the morning, right, in which he was describing how the Nestle executive came over to his PhD student talking about the problem that they were facing with, right? So what was the problem? Essentially, they had a traffic safety problem, which they're driving the milk to the milk production plant, and along the highway they have, or the road, they have these incidents, and they want to minimize them, right? So they're trying to, you know, address this issue. So how can we represent that issue, if you will, or that problem that they're trying to solve, using a simple CLT? Now, I'm not going to address necessarily the solution of the problem, but I'm giving an example of how we represent the situation, at least as I heard it. So I put down some variable names here. Okay, so we have a management perception of driving safety, because that's what I heard, right? That they think they have these incidents. There's some desired driving safety, right? There is, you know, safety shortfall, right, which would be really sort of the difference between these two. They want to, you know, invest in some safety improvement programs, quote unquote, get up to Dr. Walker's student to work on it, right? And hopefully that will impact the actual state of the driving safety. Okay, so I need your help to put arrows and make a make a diagram out of this. So who wants to volunteer? I've already laid the diagram out. Okay, so you want to come up to the board and do this? Let's do that. How much time do we have? Okay, so I'm sorry, you know what, let me speed this up, sorry. Why don't you speak it out and I'll quickly do it. Yeah, because that'll be faster. I lost track of time. Okay, so what should we do from, you know, management perception of driving safety and desired driving safety? What type of feature do we think should exist? Well, let me do that even faster, because I think I didn't realize this. So let me just quickly give you the results here of what I saw would be the case, okay? So you have reported driving safety after some type of delay, right? After some incidents have happened and things have happened, right? There's a management perception of driving safety, right? So after some time, the management realizes there's a problem. They have some desired driving safety, right? They both feed into safety shortfall. This is negative. So when the management perception of driving safety goes down, the safety shortfall goes up, right? That's why you had the negative. And then you can follow through. When the safety shortfall goes up, they want to invest more in the safety improvement program, right? That's when they approach the experts and say, hey, you want to do something about it. After some time, the experts work on it, right? So there's a delay. Then they can positively affect the state of the driving safety, okay? After some delay, there will be again some report on, you know, what's really happening. And I put these additional elements in here of bias in the reporting system and management bias toward high safety, which actually affects how things are actually perceived and acted upon. I didn't get the chance to do this right away, but I explained this, but we will get that in the next lecture. I was going to walk through some software to actually draw these CLTs, but in the interest of time, I'm going to hold off on that, and maybe in the next lecture tomorrow, I'll start with Benson, and he'll walk through actually creating a causal loop diagram, and I'll show you. For those of you who are interested, you can go to benson.com, and you can download actually a free version of the software, which allows you to build causal loop diagrams as well as process flow models. So tomorrow I'm going to work through this, but for those of you who want to, you're welcome to go to this website and download it. And then we'll work on this tomorrow together. This is free version, yes. So there's a free version, there's also a professional version, but you can get the free download on the website. So with that, I will end, and thank you very much.